So, Rob, tell us a little bit about what you do and your experience.
Okay, well, first of all, I'd like to thank you very much for inviting me to join our friends this evening.
Great to have you.
My pleasure. And it's lovely to see you again and to meet your friends. And it's nice to spend, you know, a little bit of time having a fireside chat. I will put a little bit of housekeeping out there first, that I think it's important for me to get over the message that I'm not a financial producer. Okay, I'm not a finance professional. I'm not a qualified accountant. I'm not done budgets, anything of that nature. But I do work with people that do produce those. We have teams. I'm more of a creative producer, and I work a lot more in development, as the conversation that we have will I'll go into it in more depth. But having said that, I have been in the film business for 20 years. I started on the Isle of Man as a production runner on a Channel 4 movie. Went up, worked on over 20 films there and TV productions. I went up to the role of assistant production coordinator. And then I moved here about 8 years ago to get more involved in the world of production. I have been credited as a co-executive producer. I have brought in finance on a couple of shoots, which I'm very pleased to say did quite well critically. And I think tonight I'd just like to really chat with you, share experiences I've had, little bits and pieces that I picked up along the way, because we are living in an ever-changeable world right now. I suppose you could say right now I am developing in-house projects, but also I'm acting as a kind of a connector. I'm meeting producers, and if I like the look of what they got, we try to connect them to finance leads we're picking up. And we've met some very interesting new finance leads over the course of the last 3 or 4 weeks, for example. So yeah.
Let's start at the beginning. Mm-hmm. When you receive a script, when someone sends you a script, what kind of things are you looking for? What makes you decide to take it on? And tell us a bit more about that process. What do you do?
Okay, well, I have acted as a professional script reader for a number of years. I do professional critiques. Some are very long and waffly, but I'm trying to teach myself to be more disciplined, to cut it down and get to the point. As tonight, we'll probably testify. What do I look for? A combination of factors. Is it well written? Is it original? Is it structured well? Is the pace good? Are the story arcs developed? Mm-hmm. Are the characters three-dimensional? Is it a satisfying read? I put it kind of basically to writers that I've worked with along the way. I want you to create such a believable world for me that I will laugh with the characters, cry with them, and I will punch the air with them. So it's all got to be accessible, engageable. Mm-hmm. The script needs that accessibility. I also look for whether a project will travel. If it's really parochial, I just wonder, well, a family of four from, you know, a suburb of England might like this, but will a group in America on a night out, will they get it? I'll give you one example in recent weeks. I was introduced to a project, a new script. It's a comedy drama, female-led, based on a novel. And I thought, well, should I Google the novel first to see what this is about and what reviews it's had? I thought, no, let's just go into this with fresh eyes. 8 pages in, I was hooked.
Excellent. That's what you want.
Yeah. And you know when you're doing a text to somebody and you put LOL for laugh out loud, but 9 times out of 10, you've generally got a stony face when you're saying it. I was laughing out loud. And I kept putting it down, and I was visualizing the scene, and I thought, that came out of nowhere. I was not expecting that. So I did a report on it. I did a critique, and I said, it works, but I think the third act needs a bit of adjustment, could be a bit more developed there. It doesn't quite satisfy the other two acts right now. But, and this was obviously, this is my humble opinion. That's what I say to writers. Take my critique, use it, lose it, abuse it. It's up to you, it's your baby, but this is what kind of satisfies me as a reader, and I'm trying to put myself into the mindset of a member of the audience, okay? But it's all subjective. But this is one example that if I get the script back, and the third act has been adjusted, and maybe they've taken my notes, maybe they haven't, but if it works better, I've immediately got people I want to go to about it. Because I've been given some basic information about where the structure is right now, the talent they've got penciled in to play certain roles, how much they need, and I'm thinking, I want to champion this. It's just a gut feeling. I'm not a student of people like Robert McKee and Zack Snyder. Mm-hmm. All these professional script writers and consultants. I just go by my gut. Mm-hmm. And if I think, sometimes I get a script and it's like swimming through treacle. I think, oh my God, this needs work. There's something in there, but I just can't put my finger on it, what it needs. Or if I see real talent at page 60, I'm going, I need to see that earlier.
Yeah.
But no, this particular film I'm talking about, it's just, my God, I want to help it. So I'm just waiting to hear back more information on the package and the attachments and have they fixed the third act, and we'll take it from there.
So when you get projects back or once you've decided to work on something, when you're putting together a package, what does that involve? Specifically for finance as well, what are people looking for in order to get involved with a project or to put money into it?
Okay, we've got to make sure the creative and the business elements are covered. So generally, what we'll work with them in on is you'd like to get a nice glossy brochure together, known as a deck. Mm-hmm. And that will generally include, first of all, a risk statement, and I've seen plenty of decks without them. And a risk statement is basically saying, if you can afford, if you can dispose of the of your part of your wealth or your income to invest in this, that's great. Think hard about this investment.
So basically telling an investor that it's not guaranteed that they will.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I've seen decks where they've actually said your money is guaranteed back. And I said, never, ever say that.
Oh, yeah.
No investment is guaranteed, really, especially at the moment.
Nothing is guaranteed, is it?
No. And I know some producers are trying to say, hey, wow, I've got the best project in the entire history of time. And you're guaranteed to get 1,000,000% back. And I'm thinking, no. But basically, yeah, risk statement is paramount. Also, we might want to see a synopsis. What are we about to invest in? What's the story?
Yeah.
Treatment.
I just wanted to add, those are very important because someone won't, because I get sent these as well as a producer. Yeah. And if I don't like it, I'm not going to sit there and read the whole script. So it's very important to have a synopsis to so I can gauge if I'm happy to then read further.
I mean, I'd also suggest that I've had decks where the synopsis is like what you get on the back of a book. And it's like, will they win? I want to know if they do win.
Yeah.
Well, I don't want to have to read the whole script to find out. We need to know if they win or they lose, because then we need to know what kind of emotional attachment will be put into this. Mm-hmm. It may not be the greatest emotional ending. Well, it may not be the greatest happy ending, but if it affects us emotionally still and we buy into it and engage, then yes, it can work. So yes, absolutely. Don't just do loads of question marks. Will they get out of here? Will he get the girl? Will she get the girl?
What happens?
Yeah, absolutely. We want to see the business and creative attachments, who the producers are, who the execs are, who the actors are, directors, producers, DOP, music. Yeah, that's important. We want to really see that the attachments that you have are capable of delivery.
And if the attachments are not capable of delivery, or let's say there was a character that hadn't been cast yet, would you get involved in finding the right people to be on board?
I could suggest connections to the producer to say, yes, we can get to them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Well, there's not guaranteed we hope we can get to them, but through connections I've got, I could certainly put the feelers out to say, I think that Joe Doakes would be ideal for this. Is there any way we can
make recommendations?
Yeah. So, or, you know, it's up to also the producers. They can say, well, actually, we're in talks with actor A, B, and C. And I'm thinking, well, okay, just keep us posted on that, because I think either of them could be very suitable for this, but they haven't been actually linked to the project yet. Early discussions, all of that stuff. Okay. Yeah. Budgetary information. Ideally a top sheet to go into the deck itself, but also we'd need to see the full budget because that would need to be analysed forensically. Have they allowed too much for this, not enough for that? Mm-hmm.
So the top sheet as a summary, but then also at the end of the document, the full budget.
Well, I said the full budget can be quite large sometimes, so maybe that's a separate attachment. But as long as the summary, the top sheet can be included, so it summarises what all the departments plan to spend on their output. Mm-hmm. Then, because not being a line producer, but I imagine a line producer or more of a financial expert will be able to say, I'm not sure why they've allowed that for that department. It doesn't quite add up. I need to see the full budget. Oh, right, that makes sense. Yeah. We've often seen that, you know, someone will come in and do a favour. I normally charge this, but it's you and I'll charge that.
Yeah.
Or they'll do a deferment. You know, I would like to get a bit of profit share at the end because I believe in this. So I'll go for my minimum rate. So movable feast.
Yeah.
Shooting schedule. And something else I'll come to, very important, I'll come to it at the end. Shooting schedule, so how long you plan to shoot, where you're going to be. A finance plan, which we'll go into a bit more later. Mm-hmm. Sales estimates, and they should show the low take, the mid take, and the best take. Mm-hmm. And any pre-sales that the producers have got already. A director statement, their vision, what they want to achieve, why they were attracted to this project. Sometimes a director has actually written it. So, box office comparisons and data on the market appetite for this type of genre or content. Why do we want it?
So as part of that, often people have comparable films and what they made.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And I mean, one of the most popular genres, as we know, is horror.
Yeah.
So, and that's, you know, even the lowest budget horror movies can do quite well. And of course, horror keeps coming back, like Halloween, rebooted and rebooted and rebooted. So it's always going to be there. Distribution plan. Mm-hmm. And also details of the lawyers and accountants that you have in your team.
Okay, that's very important.
And I was going to say, that's traditional, but now there's an addition that you need, because everything now should include COVID guidelines and subject to COVID. You can say, we plan to start shooting on the 1st of March 2021, but it's COVID dependent. I mean, God forbid, but there may be another sweep. In which case everything gets knocked back, as we've seen this year.
Yeah.
So yeah, the COVID comes into all of the mindset now.
All so of the planning. Will there need to be a part of the budget, a line in the budget that says for COVID safety or regulations, and as well as in the terms and conditions?
Quite possibly, yes. To allow for the extra precautions that a production would need to take, but also I mean, as I've had seen personally, shoots that were supposed to go into full production, say in the spring, and they all got knocked back. So for investment, there's going to be a delay.
I suppose it affects your amount of shoot days as well, because if you have to have certain social distancing guidelines or cleanliness guidelines, anything like that, that's going to make everything take a lot longer.
Mm-hmm.
So I would guess that you would have to have that reflected in your scheduling as well as everywhere else.
Yeah, absolutely. So as I say, into everything should go the additional bullet point to do with COVID. Mm-hmm. And how will it affect this part? Can it affect this part? How will it, what will be the cost impact, etc.?
Yeah. We'll see how that goes with production post COVID, or towards the end of COVID.
Yes. And I'd also say that when packaging, if you do hopefully come into connection with finance, whatever project it is, due diligence on either side. The investors just to make sure that the production company knows what it's doing, can deliver what it says it does, has got the track and experience. And by the same token, the production company has to know that they are dealing with the real deal. Because we've all, Natasha, you know, we've both been in the networks for a few years, and we've come across certain individuals who can promise the earth and deliver a pebble. So, so always be wary, do your homework.
You have to be careful.
Yeah.
Okay, so tell us a little bit more then about the whole process of the financial planning all the way to the end with recoupment and everything. What are the things to consider?
Okay, well, at the beginning of your journey, you're going to be calling in a lot of favours. Mm-hmm. Unless you are so lucky to get seed, because seed can be the hardest part of the budget to find, because you're going out there with an empty plate. There's no financial faith in the room yet, but you passionately believe in what you're making. And if you can get seed, this well done, but the seed can include elements such as the acquisition of the rights. So you're literally buying an option from the writer that you will have exclusive rights to their material for an agreed period of time. Does the script need more development? Okay, I'll now pay the writer to do another draft, another couple of drafts. It can include the generation of a line budget and the shooting schedule. Mm-hmm. Generation of the nice glossy deck. Mm-hmm. Well, yes, make the presentation, spend money on the presentation. You know, one bit of paper won't impress, and I've been there. Appointment of a casting director and also ancillary legal costs. Mm-hmm. And then if you're able to acquire your full production budget from what you presented, then the seed investor will normally get their investment back on day one of principal photography with a negotiated premium.
So all those costs there that you said, they would all be stuff you would pay for in advance. So this is all development money and seed money at the beginning of the process.
Yeah. I mean, like I say, seed can be very hard to find. So if you've got a line producer who's willing to do you a favor, I can do you a budget based on they will be coming on board if you get full budget or deferred payment, etc. Yeah, but any bits of seed that you can get to help the process so people can still eat and all of that, then it all helps.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So that's the seed part. The finance structure itself, when you're looking at the bigger picture, that can include things like debt equity, which is another word for loans, basically, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Private
equity. Gap finance as well. All of that is loans, basically.
Indeed. Private equity. So if you've got a rich uncle, happy days. We like rich uncles. Tax incentives based on shoot or post in whichever territory is the most attractive to your project. Because obviously
tax incentives are way after you've finished your shoot, you can claim the money back. And so you still have to find a way to cash flow that through.
That's right. That may be through the banks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, using completion bonds and the guarantee that you got the tax credit based on delivery.
And there are some companies, from what I know, there are some companies that will finance things like sales, but there's a certain minimum guarantee or financing the tax credits and things like that.
Mm-hmm. No, exactly. Just basically means you've got the cash in the bank to get going, pay the cast and crew and get principal photography started and put all the other elements into place, absolutely. And the other thing that the producer would need to think about is when the finance is in, setting up a special purpose vehicle for the production of that film.
Okay, tell us a bit more about that.
I haven't personally done that because it's other producers that have come to me, but to my understanding, it's essentially all the paperwork will be based on the special purpose vehicle that you've set up. Everything you apply for will be under that company name, and also the investment that comes in, then that can transfer to shares in that company.
So that I, because I've done this, I've set up SPVs before.
Yep.
And you basically you put all the rights and all the liabilities into the one entity. Mm. So everything is in one place. And if it makes money, great. And if it doesn't and you need to close the company, you're not closing any of your other businesses. It's mm. all in the one place. So you get your investors and you can sell shares because it's all in the same thing. If you were to split it into different projects, then you would it would be too complicated to try to work out what is, and then everyone would own parts of all the different projects.
That's very muddy and complicated.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, unless investment is received for a slate, which is a conversation for later. But if it's for this particular production, absolutely. So all the liability is held by the SPV that one has set up.
Yeah. So if you have your insurance is for that company, and then obviously any money you make or any investment that comes in goes into the company as well. All the rights are held within the company. It's all in the same one place, basically.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, but on the Isle of Man, when I started out, my contract would be with, what was it? A company did Hound of the Baskervilles, and they set up a special company, I think, called Tiger Espect Hound Isle of Man Limited. So absolutely, yeah. Specially made for the purpose.
Yeah.
Now, the other things that go into the mechanism is SEIS and EIS. Now, I have not personally had much experience of these because, as I'll come on to a little bit later, the financiers that I'm talking to are all based outside the United Kingdom. But this is, of course, as you know, Natasha, because you've had experience of this, it's an HMRC, it's a UK government mechanism, in order that a UK-based investor can claim tax rebate on their investment. But they have to have their investment held within this mechanism for a set period of time. I think it's 3 years.
3 years, yeah.
Yeah.
So just to clarify for everyone who doesn't know, we're talking about EIS, which is Enterprise Investment Scheme. And then you have SEIS, which is Seed Enterprise Investment Scheme. So there are two different tax incentives for UK investors to get a tax, some of their tax money back from the government when they invest in a project.
Absolutely. And I believe that the SEIS is capped at 150,000.
Yeah, it's capped at 150,000 total.
Yep. And the EIS is capped at 1 million per annum.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I hope that the SEIS and the EIS will continue. I know they've changed the ruling on it, that before producers could apply based on one individual product. Mm-hmm. But I think these mechanisms were always intended for long-term businesses. Mm-hmm. that could produce projections of, you know, 2 to 3 to 4 years turnover, including staff employment and product output. So now it's based on, I understand, a production company with a slate of product.
Yeah. So yeah. I think it was obviously initially thought to help other kinds of businesses for a period of time rather than just for one project. And then obviously it was utilized by film producers as well. And so in recent years, it has become very difficult to get SEIS or EIS money. I do know some people who have managed to do it, so it is possible, but again, you have to be able to demonstrate that you have a slate of productions rather than just a single project. And they have clamped down on the process, so it's much more difficult than it used to be. And I think some of the particular regulations are around what I was saying earlier, where you can have someone to cash flow things like sales estimates or the tax recoupment.
The rebate.
Yeah. So what happened is some producers were offering the tax incentives like SEIS or EIS to investors, but then giving them guaranteed money out of the tax credit as well. So then actually the investors had no risk whatsoever, which defeats the object of the scheme, because investment is a risk, and it should be. And hopefully everyone makes money, but it's a risk that you have to take.
Yeah, as we said earlier, every investment is a risk, whatever business you go into. So, yeah. There's, like I was saying, I have very little experience of HMRC and these mechanisms, because literally in the past few weeks, I have been connected to financiers in Canada, in America, in Germany, in Russia, and they in turn have connections to finance in China and the Middle East. And these are like wealth funds and private equity investors. So it'll be interesting to see over the course of the next few weeks how they all go. I mean, we've got some very exciting projects that we are promoting to them, and talks are happening now. For one particular project, which I'm very excited about, we have the full investment deck today, and it runs for about 45 pages. There's a lot there. but yeah. Now, the other thing, I was going to say that there are, of course, public domain, there are funds that are known in the public domain, such as the BFI and Screen Yorkshire and the funds in Scotland. But I have no experience of them. I've not applied to them. I can't really comment on those.
I have applied to a few of those. Again, very competitive, very difficult to get that kind of funding. We'll talk a bit more about this, I'm sure, at some point. But there are like you said, there's private equity, there's GAP, there's different kinds of financing. And any of these national or regional funds, particularly in the UK, as you said, you've been dealing with other countries, particularly in the UK, they're very competitive, and it's very difficult to get money from those kinds of public bodies.
You can have the best script in the world, and, you know... Yeah. The other thing is that in the experience of the production companies that I've had, so I haven't generated these documents, but to my knowledge, the contract isn't signed off with the investment until what's called the heads of terms or an inter-party agreement is agreed and signed off with all the parties participating, so everybody knows what everybody's getting, because it can be a movable feast. Entity A could say, I'll put in this money, but I want this. And the producer will say, no problem. And then entity B comes along and says, well, I can put in that much for you, but I want this. Well, we've already promised that to entity A. Oh, we need to jiggle things around here.
So it's like a big puzzle where all the pieces have to simultaneously fit. It's no good having bits of it at different times, and you have to have it all in one.
Yeah, it's a little bit like preparing a feast for people of very, very, very dietary requirements, and suddenly you find out your latest guest actually can't eat that, but they can eat that. Oh, we better get more of that in. Yeah.
Yeah.
So generally the contracts won't be finally signed off until the inter-party agreement is fully complete. Everyone's happy. Then individual contracts will be signed off by the respective parties. To my knowledge. So yeah, that's my base, my main understanding about that part of the mechanism.
So when we talk about the different terms for the different parties, what we're inferring to is the different recoupment, and people refer to this as the waterfall. Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about that. If you hear waterfall being mentioned, what does that involve, and what are the different parts to that?
Well, I'd love it if it meant an all expenses paid trip to Niagara Falls, but sadly it doesn't. It's basically a document with showing where all the investors lie in the recoupment schedule, mm-hmm. who's first out, who is last out, and the time period that it'll cover.
Okay.
That's the general construct of it.
Yeah. So any kind of loans, or what we were saying earlier, gap financing, any stuff like that, usually although it comes in last in most cases, it usually is required to come out of the money first. So they get their money back, then I suppose you pay any deferments and things like that usually. But all the bodies that we were saying, like the BFI or any money that you've had from there, they might say where they want to be in the waterfall. And then private equity usually comes out at the end. Like we said, this is usually, but it can be different. Everyone has different terms and conditions, different things that they want. So it's all changeable and it depends on the project, but this is a guideline of how it usually takes place.
No, absolutely. I mean, you just triggered off a meeting that we had the other week, in that, and that, then again, the juggling comes in because I was introduced to an entity. They said, how much is this project looking for? And it was reasonably substantial. And they said, we can cover all of that. Everything. You don't need anything else. We can fund the whole lot. Then that means that they take financial control. Well, that could mean they take financial control. And do you want one entity to have financial control of perhaps, I know studio pictures are different and that's another conversation, but if it's like an independent film, it's a case of the stakeholders, how much, so some investors, they will just happy to invest their money and let the professionals get on with it. Other investors, I think, will want more of a say in how things go. Get rid of that actor. I want this actor. I don't like that director, etc. Mm-hmm. So yeah, and of course that can also, if you have maybe two or three investors like that who come in with some powerful injection, then it's a bit of a juggling match as to where they will come in the waterfall.
Yeah.
Generally, I think with private investors, that's where the term pari passu comes in. They will all get their money at the same time, albeit at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's usually how it works, is everything else comes out first. Sales agents take their cut, any deferred payments, any loans, that all comes out first, and then private investors at the end, but all simultaneously, rather than one getting money back first or anything like that, it gets
split. Yeah, because we were talking about before, my background was with the Isle of Man Film Commission, and I think their general remit was the film has to have all its finance in place apart from what you need from us, and then we will be first out.
Okay.
I believe that's the remit that they had. Yeah.
So again, all of these bodies, you can see they have different terms and conditions. So you really have to just read what each one wants. And remember, they all change as well all the time. So every time you do a new project, make sure you check, because you don't want to be going with the wrong information. And then at the end, you realize, oh dear, I have a hole in my budget, or whatever the problem is. It's better to know straight away and go through everything with a fine tooth comb.
Absolutely. Transparency.
Yeah.
So
another thing that's really important when putting together a package and getting investors on board are sales estimates. Can you tell us a bit more about that, and how does one go about finding sales estimates?
Okay. Traditionally, you would go to a sales agent, or you can approach a distributor direct if you have a relationship. But traditionally, the sales agent gets involved. They can produce estimates for a fee, or they can do it as part of the package if you negotiate with them to come on board as your dedicated sales agent for a film. Find an agent that's going to be a good match for you, because if, say, you're doing the latest film featuring actor A, and they say, oh, I'm not really sure about them, I'm not really too keen on them, you think you're the wrong match. You need to find somebody who's passionate about that actor, about the product, and can really bang the drum about it and really believe in it. So if you can find that person, they'll do their utmost to sell, and they take will be between 15% to 30% of commission on the sales. Now, they're traditionally important in terms of box office estimations. I don't think, well, I could be wrong, they don't generally take into account sales to broadcasters, you know, the onward, like the rest of that part of the another waterfall. And it's important that they show to the investor the level of projected return, which can be split into two or three sections. Generally, the yes, the worst case scenario that we'll accept for this movie, a conservative take, and the best case scenario. But whatever the final estimate you generally discount, I think up to about 30%, because there are some territories where you will not be able to sell a film. Okay. In the perfect world, the ask, the best case scenario, should be the budget times 3. So it covers everything. But that rarely happens. The take is the worst case scenario, but as long as it shows a profit. Mm-hmm. If the film's a million and they say the worst case you'll make 200K, then to an investor, that's not great news. Also, from salespeople I know, they like to see pre-sales if they can. And if a pre-sale matches the estimate or is very close to the sales estimate, yes, we've sold it to America, we thought it would get a million, and it has made 900,000 or 1,100,000. They think, oh, right, this guy knows what he's talking about. That's comfortable for me. So that means that, yes, I think this film will hopefully do well. Mm-hmm. However, as we said, the estimates are based on box office, but now, of course, as we know, we're in a very changeable landscape. Mm-hmm. Cinemas are now dipping a gentle toe into the shallow end. Mm-hmm. So it'll be interesting to see how that manifests itself over the coming period. And I think a lot of focus now is being put towards the streamers, the Amazons and the Netflix and the HBOs. I mean, for example, the latest Tom Hanks movie, Greyhound, that was intended for cinematic release this summer, I believe, but it's gone straight to the streamers.
Yeah, and a lot of releases have been pushed back as well.
So yeah.
Very unknown territory at the moment.
Mm. I mean, we're used to box office openers. We're used to, like, the Star Warses and the Bonds. I mean, Bond is now due to come out in November. Supposedly big charity premiere at the Royal Albert Hall. Will it be a full house that night? Who knows? And if the cinemas do open, health and safety precautions will, of course, be paramount. So where do you expect a full house on a weekend opener? It may only be half full because it has to be half full.
Yeah.
So I'd say I'd take a quote from the great William Goldman, the screenwriter who wrote Adventures in the Screen Trade. Now, back then, he was quite right that when you write something and you produce something, nobody knows anything. You don't know if you're going to write a hit or a turkey. You just go for what you believe in. But now that phrase is even more palpable in our current world. Nobody knows anything. The cinemas may feel confident enough to expand a bit more, and then suddenly that nasty thing comes back again. Mm. So we just don't know. It's a very, very unprecedented times. So I'd say, yeah, sales estimates, they are important for investment. You want to give the investment as much comfort factor as possible, but it has to be, it's a movable piece. It has to be flexible thinking based on the climate.
So as part of that, is having a distribution plan as well?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I've seen certain decks that merely talk about exposure of films at film festivals. Pardon me. And that's fine, all power to them. Get a good sale at a film festival. They are important. They're part of our community. Long may they continue. But I think if you can get pre-market interest, it is valuable. And of course, allow for marketing in the budget. Mm-hmm. Don't just rely on a bit of social media. You know, if you can get good publicity behind you, I think you should get the word out there, because a good publicist will really do their homework and make sure that the impact can be as strong mm-hmm. as they can make it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. So, final things about terms of investment then. Mm-hmm. What are people often wanting to get in order to get involved with the project?
It can be a game of tennis. Mm-hmm. Some investors can put money in for recoupment plus a percentage of producer's net profit share. It's normally producers at 50% and investors at 50%, but pro rata aggregate to the level of the investment they put in. But you can have it that if a project is intended for longevity, there are plans to be sequels, there could be some great merchandise, toys, all of that stuff, t-shirts. An investor may think, well, okay, I could negotiate on my percentage of profit share, but I want a piece of this bigger pie. And if there's going to be a 2 and a 3 and a 4, and there's going to be cartoons, there's going to be TV, there's going to be games, all of that stuff, I want a piece of it. So, it's a case by case, I think. Mm-hmm. But also, when you're coming to that contractual place, make sure you've got an experienced media lawyer by your side who can go through the contract with a fine-tooth comb to make sure that it's fair, mm-hmm. it's reasonable, and they will look out for all the little bits and pieces. And then they will suggest either this is good or no, I think we should go back about these points.
Yeah, definitely. Legal things is not something where you think, I'll read through that. That's not a problem. I can, we'll wing that. That's fine. Don't do that. Get a lawyer.
Yes, absolutely. Because people can become unstuck and you don't want that. Because also, you want to be in a situation, especially if you're an emerging filmmaker, that, we say you can only go to the well once. No, you want to go twice, three times, four times. If the relationship has worked, if the investor is happy with how you conducted yourself, how the film has, as the product has performed, they like your style, and there's a trust has built up, good synergy there. They'll think, well, okay, what's your next one? Let's take a look at that. And I made my money back, which is the most important thing. But that is subject to the audiences and the markets and what have you. Because I was going to quickly say, and I know we were talking very briefly about distribution before, but that's also where a sales agent can be very helpful to you. They can work with you in a distribution plan to cover not only the cinemas and the streamers, but also you've got to think about home entertainment going forward. DVDs, Blu-rays, used to be cable and VOT broadcast, the networks, BBC, ITV, all of that. So yes, get a good sales agent in the room and they can brief you more in depth mm-hmm. over that element. Yeah.
Yeah, good advice. So do we have any other final tips of things people need to consider when putting together a project?
I'd say think of the market. Mm-hmm. Always have the market paramount. It has happened before, but try not to start off with a passion. No, not the word passion, because passion projects can be strong. A vanity project. I love this to death, but will everybody else?
Yeah.
Yeah. Think of it also. I suggest you don't go in with the mindset of, isn't it great? I'm going to make a movie. You've got to think, I'm making a business opportunity here. Mm-hmm. And I want to provide good entertainment or meaningful drama or whatever it is to the audience. But I also want to make sure that my business partners are satisfied. They're impressed. We recoup, that we know there is a market appetite for this. It's the current flavor. Because it can also be a chicken and egg thing. It might be, at the moment, the big thing could be Westerns. You think, let's make a Western. And by the time you achieve it and deliver it, the big thing is romantic comedies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just keep an eye on the market, see what's trending. Sometimes a film comes out of nowhere and takes everybody by shock. And then sort of, who would have thought Parasite?
Yeah.
Which was, came out of nowhere, and it was a very thoughtful film, quite deep, quite dark, comedic. It covered a lot of angles, but my goodness, it did well.
Yeah.
So, think about what you want to make. Will it make an impact? Why will it make an impact? And it's what you believe in. But try and cover all the business elements.
So thinking about what other people will want to watch as well, not just what you want to make, also thinking about others.
Exactly. And would you put your own money into it? Mm. Have you got your life savings? Okay. Will you put half your life savings into that?
Yeah. Yeah. Good sign. But don't ever put your own money in, though.
Mm. No, I mean, there are some producers out there they're a special kind of community in which they are high net worth, so they can afford to. And generally, they might be a passion or a vanity project, but hey, it's what they wanted to do. But yeah, as you say, Natasha, definitely.
Yeah, if you can convince someone else to part with their money, then I always think that's a great gauge of whether you've got an interesting project, because you do everything and you finance it all yourself, and you write the script, and you direct it, and you do all the editing, and you do all the producing. And if you do everything on the project, then there isn't anyone to say that it's not good. So I think if you can convince other people, then you're more likely to make a better product for everyone else as well.
Absolutely. And then word spreads and you make it more impactful. Mm-hmm. And that's the way you build up business relationships. And then your network increases.
Yeah.
Mm. And that's what this is all about, I think, at the moment, because we were talking before, and because we are in such a strange climate at the moment, we're hoping for the best, we're hoping we'll come out of this soon, but who knows how long it'll take. I think there's never been a more important time that we've all got to look after each other, because we hear new developments every day, things that we thought were going to happen aren't. The feast is going to be an even quicker movable feast. Yeah. Nobody knows anything, but the more input, the more data, the more information we get and share, that helps our mindsets to be able to shape what we're doing.
Yeah.
We want to support each other.
So does anyone have any questions? If you can, pop them into the chat box. And I'll ask them before we finish. But this has been a great talk, Rob.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, I feel like I've learned something as well, which is always excellent.
Well, and this is the way we compare notes, and it all makes a difference. And I found the conversation really valuable on my side too.
Great.
Because I think it's different skills that different people bring in. You're as strong as a team around you.
Yeah.
And it is literally the case that I don't know that, but I know somebody who does.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, it's been really positive. And I think what you're doing, Natasha, to bring the communities together and keep talk and keep fellowship and networking and gathering active, even though it's still virtual.
Yeah.
I congratulate you.
Thank you. Oh, so we do have one question.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a question? No, it's more of a statement. Thanks.
Oh.
Says thank you and lots of other things. You can see that there, Rob. I think it's to everyone.
Hang on. I think my chat box is slightly reduced, so I'll see if I can just click on it and I can see properly what it says. Oh, I've got the group chat open now.
Yeah.
I'm a bit of a technophobe sometimes. Well, thank you very much, John. And yes. I'm glad we've been of help. And like I say, it's what Natasha's doing here. She's bringing different people, her friends from the business who cover different aspects, but it all goes to provide a rounded picture, and it all goes to provide an updated, a regularly updated rounded picture.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Rob, for all your information.
Not at all.
We'll all keep in touch. There'll be another. I don't really know what to call them. Another masterclass in a couple of weeks' time. So we'll see you there. But thank you very much, Rob.
Not at all. And I was also going to quickly say that if anybody, the points we've referred to tonight, if anybody wants to know anything more in depth, we can always point them in the right direction of the specialists we know.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Great.
Excellent. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a lovely weekend.
Thank you. Take care.